punch not to use the flag in arms. What allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, and indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can I get actions on the minutes from scheduled meeting of 6/2016?
So moved. Second.
Councilman Craywalker and... Any comments or questions? Any discussion?
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craywalker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Minutes passed, 7-0.
All right, communications tonight. Mr. Britt, would you like to address that?
Absolutely. We have communication to the State of Ohio Treasurer's Office about the online check. All right, we take the voting, sir. Where you can, if you need to sit there for your rest.
Yeah, I do. Is it being recorded? Is it okay? Okay.
If you speak up real loud, we can hear you.
Okay. All right, great. Thank you guys for having me. My name is Frank Kostal, the Deputy Director of Public Affairs, the State Treasurer John Stevens' office. Here to talk about our free voluntary program called OhioCheckbook.com. A little bit of background on it. Josh was elected in 2010, so his term in 2011. Came into the office and noticed that Ohio was continually ranked in the bottom of the bucket as far as transparency. Transparency in government is one of these movements where, kind of like in our daily lives, it's not online, it doesn't really exist. And so there was a group out of Boston called the U.S. PERS, Public Interest Research Group. They put out a ranking every year. It's called Follow Your Taxpayer Money. And Ohio was D-minus and 46th in the nation for a few years. And he asked the staff, like, what can we do to better this? Who's in charge of this around the state? Really no one is. So we have access to the Treasurer's Office to all the state financials. So he said, why don't we start a website and put in our expenses online? It took about 18 months to develop. Cost about $800,000, but we were able to achieve something really extraordinary. We launched it back in December of 2014. The new rankings came out in March of 2015. We went from 46th in the nation to first. So we're now leading the nation as far as the level of transparency that states are providing. That was followed up this year by being ranked number one in the nation. So we're still kind of leading with what we built. I can show you the state site in a second, but we didn't want to stop there. We wanted to offer the same functionality, the same type of website that we built for the state to all local governments across Ohio, kind of empowering citizens and taxpayers, but also giving a tool for the elected officials around the state to interact and to communicate what their goals and agendas are, and to showcase how you guys are spending taxpayer money, one of the priorities. Problem was, does anyone know how many local governments there are in Ohio?
A lot.
There's almost 4,000 local governments. So when I started on this project from the very beginning. One of the earliest duties I was tasked with was finding out what type of accounting systems cities and villages and townships use. You know, the state, we're on one uniform accounting system for all departments and agencies. So a pack of pencils at the Treasurer's Office is a pack of pencils at the Board of Dermatology. Not so local government. What you guys might classify as a pack of pencils under office supplies, Clark County might classify as office equipment. So there's really no uniformity. And it's also the way of exporting the data. What we're talking about is a pretty simple spreadsheet, an Excel file that you run out of your system that has your expenses, but it's different for all kinds of local governments. Of the 4,000, 1,800 of them are on the system through the State Auditor's Office called UAN, Uniform Accounting Network. So right there, once we figure out their system, we knew that all they had to do was run two files, save it, and email it to us, and we're able to build out a website form. Schools were kind of the next subcategory, about 614 school districts across the state. 99% of them are on the same accounting system. There's a few that have decided by the round, but I won't get into that. So right there, about 2,400 of the 3,900 local governments, we had a really good idea, and we had a really easy process for implementation. They wanted to join, it took only a matter of minutes. But then We work directly with those companies, create partnerships. They actually built us a specific checkbook report for all their users. That has now been live for about 6 to 8 months. So very, very easy for software solutions and CMI users. So they are at 75-80%. What I do on a daily basis is I go out and work with a lot of the ad local systems. So I meet a lot with counties, a lot with some larger entities that have home built county IT servers and software. And work on just trying to pull the data out to a better format to make it easy. And when they want to join, we really do mean this as a partnership. For the most part, we have it down to less than 30 minutes across the board. A lot of people don't believe that I say that. But we do have, you know, some proof here, some video tutorials. We have instructions for a lot of the accounting systems. So if a new product does decide to join, I can guarantee you guys that it's going to take less than 30 minutes to sign up. The process, I can show you right off the bat. So the standard process that we have across the state is once the government says, hey, we're committed, we want to do this, we send them an intake form. Standard intake form, it just goes over the program a little bit more. But it's 4 pages. We just redid this actually to make it easier. The old form was a bit cumbersome, and you had to fill out all the fields to get to the next page. Folks wanted to see what was in the dang intake form before they actually, you know, submitted it. And so it was confusing people. But here, you just come on in, organization name, some basic information for who's preparing it, usually an auditor, a finance director, or treasurer. But then we have specific accounting system instructions. So I believe you guys are on SSI eGov, is that correct? We can go up to the third page, and it says when actually you get to upload your data, here's a written guide on how to export it out. We have very specific instructions. I found with software solution users, if they do not have this open checkbook report on their software, it's a simple update. They go to softwaresolutions.com, they log in with their member login, it gets you to like the customer side of things, and you can download all their software updates off that page. In fact, I was just in the city of Geneva in Ashtabula County 2 weeks ago. It wasn't populating on our software. We went and downloaded it. We ran it. You can see where it's put in a specific year, doing the whole account string, starting about what months or time periods we're looking for, department levels. These are things that the finance director knows. What's your department level of your account string? You run it, you save it, you email it to us. We'll actually go back up. You attach it to your intake form. Once you submit the intake form, we get it, we build out the site. It usually takes 2 or 3 business days to build. And then we schedule what we call a reviewer kickoff call. So this right here, intake form, less than 30 minutes to get it signed up. The kickoff call is once we have the site built, we'll get in touch and say, hey, it's ready. We're going to show it to you, show how it works. And then turn private control over to the local government. So the main point of contact would be an email. They're considered an administrator of the checkbook website. They log in, they can create a password, so it's a password protected website that stays private. It'll never be made public until you guys explicitly approve of it. You'll have plenty of time to review, as long as it needs to take. Sometimes the process, it differs with every local government. Sometimes you want to run it by department heads, you want to present it to council before it's formally approved. We let the local government decide on the best way to proceed. So you guys have plenty of time to review it. Once you say, hey Frank, it looks good, I think we're ready to go, then we'll make it live and put you guys on local.ohiocheckbook.com. So this is an interactive, what we just call a landing page. If you go to ohiocheckbook.com, it takes you to our state site. If you're interested in searching $530 billion of state expenditures, you go there, all of our local governments are on the second tab. We have over 360 live sites now. We've been live since September of 2015. You know, we announced this local partnership opportunity over a year ago, back in April of 2015. We sent out a letter saying, if anyone's interested, let us know. We'll start working with you on getting your data into other sites. We built the first 100 between April and September, and then we launched the first 115, and we've been growing ever since. So you can zoom in the map to find your local governments. Here is the Bell Center, where you can scroll down, and they're partitioned out by government type cities and villages, quite a few townships. See what counties we taxpayer money and a really good communication tool. So let me go up. Close one. Newport Heights is one of the closest cities. Let me click in. And here's how it's being displayed. So right off the bat, we're showing what departments and what time frames we're looking at. So we're looking at all departments. And Newport Heights decided to go back to 2006. This is another decision that each entity gets to have. How far do you want to go back? We recommend 2 to 5 years off the bat, so you have a couple of graphs. So you can compare spending year over year. Just kind of puts the spending into more context. I noticed, and I did a little research whenever I come out and present to council, so I saw a recent article about your guys' pool being back open this year. It's great. I love swimming. I'm big at good pools. But to show you kind of what it would look like within other folks or other governments, we built this Google style search. It's really the easiest way to search this data. So as I just start typing out pool, it's going to bring up not only the vendors that they're using that contain that in it, Astro Pools, Dayton Pool Management, the Huber Pool, but then if they have a specific department or agency or expense category for that expense, we click in the pool. We control that, so here we're looking at that department. We can see one of the expense accounts underneath it. It looks like most of it, they actually contracted out to YMCA to run their pool. And then it's showing improvements, equipment and maintenance. We can click in and actually switch it over and look at what vendor names are being used out of a specific department, specific fund, specific expense account. So really granular. Here we're looking at it looks like it's just two payments. Back in 2009, Sunbelt Rentals. We can click on any individual expenditure, view the check details. Obviously, knowing local governments don't cut a lot of checks these days, but by putting the spending information into a check image, it makes it much more digestible for the common public to see spending in, you know, personal banking type visuals. So here, they can quickly reference a specific check number, the date, who it's going to. The memo line is great. We can map this to any piece of information we have in a data file. So most of the time, it's going to be your expense account category, equipment maintenance. But you might have a purchase, a PO description, or a memo line within the data that might actually say, you know, we wanted two front-end loaders for 10 hours. Whatever the description is, we can put that into the memo line. Schools have that. I know CMI does, I don't know if my software solutions has a, we call it a user-defined section of your data. If folks have questions, if I'm not just going to call you, you build an internal mechanism, you know, questions about this payment, don't be scared of that. But the 360 we have online, we have some of the largest entities across the state, either the county, Franklin County, Hamilton County, all the way down to villages with less than 100 people, townships with less than 100 people that have sites. It does not increase public records requests, it does not increase scrutiny, it actually has done the opposite. Delaware County for a while was getting a lot of requests for some of their capital improvement projects. Once they put their checkbook out there, they've only had one question come through, and it's actually from someone that just needed help learning how to use the site. So it has not increased, you know, public records requests. I think Warren County to date has had over 700 visitors since September. Not one public records request on their check. So let me exit out and reset. There's a couple of the neat little tools to go with. The top is showing the number of checks or expenditures representing. So here you have 188,000, totaling about $775 million. If I just want to see, gosh, what are the largest payments? You know, where are they spending the most money? We can go over the aggregates. Here we're looking at, let me back up, sorry. Check counts by amount. So, you know, they're writing the most, their expenditures are writing the most between $10 and $100. That doesn't tell me much. But what is neat is I can run this over name. Instead of showing check count, showing check total. Right here we have a list, police and fire pension, Mellon Bank, Master Construction. We can click into any individual vendor. Come over, it's going to show all those payments, 45 payments over the last 3 years. And you see, I don't think from the Cuba Heights, but they built a really nice music center down on I-70. All of this displayed here in the check. I'll shut up for a minute and take any questions. I know I talk fast. I know this stuff in and out, so yes.
I have two questions. From the public interface, it looks like it's really usable, you know, clicking, going through it. So my first question I have, though, is as far as a government entity uploading the data, let's say there's an issue, a problem, do you guys have a service where you can call and get sort of help walking through any issues?
Yeah, absolutely. So we do that. I do that all the time. The city of Akron, for example, sent in their file last week. He emailed me first thing this morning during the review process. We had a kickoff call. He's logging in, looking at it. He says, Frank, you know, everything looks great. Everything's adding up, you know, fine. The totals here for each individual year, he's spot checking and cross-referencing with what you know, was in the budget document, say we spent $50,000. He's doing his due diligence. But then, because what we display is all a matter of public record anyway, we do hang the raw data out there. You download them into Excel if someone wanted to. Well, he did. He spot checked, he downloaded all fiscal years and noticed that actually the files there were aggregating too much. They were deflated by like $26 million. So, Frank, I don't know what's going on if you check it out. We do that all the time. So, from the very beginning, I go out and run the files with finance directors all the time. I sit down with them. We get it done in 15 minutes. If there's any, you know, what we call redactions or corrections that need to be made, we do that, we do screen shares, we'll come out and visit. We really do need a partnership. So yes, there are plenty of processes in place to help folks out.
And the second question I had dealt with the where you can submit questions, where someone from the public can submit questions. Where is it go? Does it go to your office? Does it go, do we sync up whoever's email with this account? So how does that work?
We can set up as many checkbook administrators as we want. It'll send an email alert. So anyone that is identified on the control panel, which I can show
to
you.
To their city email account or whatever account they choose to.
Correct. It'll say you've had a question come in. You go to opengov.com, that's our partner, so you hire to build the sites. We don't have enough staff in the treasurer's office to build 4,000 sites. So you go there, you go to the control panel, kind of the back end of the checkbook, which we teach everyone how to use. From there you access the engagement, which will show your questions. You can also log in and see our folks using our site, how many visitors that we have. So you actually get some information back as far as the usage. So this is the control panel. So after the kickoff call, whoever the main point of contact is, their username is their email, and then in the email they can create a password. They can send that username and password around to council so they can log in. You can make anyone administrators just by including them in the settings. We can set as many users as we like. You always have full access to your data, so you'll be able to see what files we have that are up, that are displaying. We teach you how to update it, so an update schedule is up to the local government, and we don't mandate or say that you have to update it monthly or quarterly. We ask that you do it at least once a year to make it somewhat timely and usable for your citizens. You have full access to it, but here in your portal, and this is a dummy site, so it's not public, so it doesn't have any visitors. You get to see the number of visitors over the last 90 days, and then the engagement section is where the questions will be. You can also, I should show you this. The big thing is, we can't show revenue, hopefully one day we get there. This is a progression. This program is always building and getting new things. One of them is we're able to hang some documents on the side. So a lot of folks have questions about showing revenue, not just expenses. We can't build that into the graphing yet, but we can hang some static documents out there, CAFRs, budget documents, so if someone does have a question, they can simply click over and your documents go up. You can also put in some saved views. So if you have a couple frequently asked questions that you guys get, We can build those in. It's pretty simple. You know, if I'm looking at the fire and I want to see what they're paying for vehicles for the fire department, I can save this and say, what does Huber Heights spend on fire trucks? Add that, reset it, and click in, and it takes me right into that save view. So essentially it's an FAQ. You can put in a couple, canned or, what your frequently asked questions are. And it's an easy, very quick way for your citizens to go on to look at. It's also really good, it's a little different with software solutions because we're finding more evidence with the folks that are on UAM. It's a pretty basic accounting system. But they're actually logging in and using their checkbook during council meetings, during board of trustee meetings. It's 24/7 access, it's always up. During budget requests or whatnot, instead of having the finance director run all these reports, you can bring your laptop in and you guys can have a work session by pulling up most recent data, what we spent in this area last year, the last 2 years, and kind of use it as an internal management tool as well, because it's so easy to search the data and it's got the built-in visualizations.
I saw the check in age and all that. So how does it, say Colleen sends in something on Excel, does it take that information then and start to put it into the various areas by itself? We don't have to,
randomly
input everything. So it's like a QuickBook.
The only thing that we ask before you send in the data, and again, this is what I help folks with all the time, cities and counties have the most exposure for confidential personal information. I actually found a city that was using social security numbers for their vendor ID numbers. That's just bad practicing, but we were able to catch that before they were sending anything out. But for cities and municipalities, the number one piece of redacted information is by income tax refunds. That payment is a matter of public record, the individual name or recipient is not. So just depending on the accounting system, I can show you what basic data file looks like. As we're just taking your fund code, with your description, so we know how to map out your chart accounts. That's cool view. But for a redaction process, for income tax checks, all we have to do is filter a column, look for income tax. It's going to bring up all those transactions. Come over to the vendor name, you highlight all of them, replace it. They replace it with one-time check. You put income tax check. That's pretty simple Excel work. We have, video tutorials. We have a whole resource center that we try to teach folks that they don't know how to do it. The onus is on the local government. We do help out quite a bit with it. But that's why we just say, hey, don't send us things you don't want to display. We'll work with you on cleaning up before we do. I've loaded stuff up and said, gosh, we forgot about this department. Well, I just send them the file again, they take it out, and we re-upload it. So, pretty simple.
Hey, I was told that we can live in the public. Now, how many people actually use it?
Great question. So, I don't have access to, if you guys signed up, I don't have access to your control panel to see how many users. I have a team, actually, two women, one in Cleveland, one in Cincinnati, our offices. They're going out right now and interviewing the folks that are coming online since September. And more recently, have to log in and check. Really depends on the community, honestly. The village of Opta, that only has 70 people, is probably not going to have a couple thousand visitors. But Warren County's had, over 500. In fact, I think it was the city of North Royalton, all the way up in Cuyahoga County. Didn't really think anyone was going to use it, so they were only going to update it once a year. Well, Jessica went out with them, we logged on. I think he had 150 visitors. So gosh, we were actually going to this thing, I better update it a little bit more often, and now he's going to be updating it quarterly. So again, that's one of the things that you want to see, are people using it? No. If not, make a decision. It's a free program. If a year from now no one's using it, you guys want to get out of it or don't want to update it monthly, update it annually, it's up to you. It's free of all time. less than 30 minutes.
How much of the time did actually the initial setup?
Yeah.
You say it's less than 30 minutes. Then if you go back 5, 6, 7 years, I don't see how you can have it be a 30 minute for everyone to have different people behind the scenes doing different skill sets on maybe software programs you're using or maybe challenges working with a program just like that. So for across the board 30 minutes, I don't think it's a fair shot. I think realistically, if we go back 5 years, how long should it take to get everything correct?
So again, your initial data file from here to run 5 years, less than 30 minutes. How long it takes you to maybe review it if you want to look at your departments, that's up to you. Right off the bat with Self-First Solutions, we have one of the easiest processes in place across the state. That's why I can come in and say it's going to take less than 30 minutes. I would not sit here if this were, Shelby County, who has, Department of Mental Disabilities, JFS, and they have a whole lot of, kind of a lot of different processes that they approve. But for, cities, villages, schools, and townships, I do have to come out and sit with you, but I can guarantee it'll be less than 30 minutes.
So it pulls out all the information already in the software. So already go back and manually enter, or even the Excel sheet spits out for 2010. We're going to go through that Excel sheet. Is the formatting going to be correct and all that?
Yep, that's why we partnered with Software Solutions. Because we had found some different RE reports, right? CMI has we still run the stuff process with CMI. They have run four files. Their chart accounts files, so the funds, their departments or projects, whatever they call them, depends on the city, and their expense accounts, and then they have a detailed transactions by all accounts report. So once I upload those four, going forward, they just upload the detailed transactions. But CMI actually came out with a specific checkbook report for now. So again, it's a matter of, are their users having those current up-to-date pieces of software from CMI or Software Solutions? You guys have the This has been out there, I think, since September for Software Solutions, so should have a checkbook report on that financial reporting software. If not, like I said, you just go to softwaresolutions.com, log in, and it's ready to download. So,
Another question I have is I know it's bad, we call out his own checkbook, but the only thing that comes up is reps.
Oh, so you're not on the local site, you're on the state site.
So there's two different sites.
Yeah, so this is all the state spending. So
both search and Carlisle.
Yep. It's
I'm not against it. I think my concerns are if, in the last speaking last fall, it was still very new and they were working out a lot of bugs. And to go with that, we have just converted over to SSI in the last year and we're still working out our bugs. So it's not something I'm comfortable with starting today. I think our last communication was when we get a little more caught up and snapped. Obviously, I believe it takes more than the 30 minutes to download because I wouldn't walk away from it at that point. I would want to look at it, I'd want to check it, make sure that what's out there is right against mine.
Yep.
And then I don't see it being an advantage unless we did do it every month. And again, that's every month checking. So it's more of a time management at this time. I would like to see us not jump into it so quickly. I would like to still have maybe a little time before we get a little more serious. But the program's nice. I mean, there's nothing, it's just, I think, timing for me right now.
I get that a lot. And no disrespect to you. I hear that all the time, and until folks sit down and actually do it, they don't really know what it really entails. I try to come off as genuine as I can, so it really means less than 30 minutes. And so that's why I'm willing, you know, I go out all the time and sit down with folks and run the files, and once they see it, gosh, that's all it takes. Yeah, that's all it takes.
And then they don't do anything after that 30 minutes, so they're done.
Well, then we have to
schedule.
Well,
you'd be done. I wouldn't have to do anything else.
We'll get that, that'll be for the intake form. So we run the files, get that submitted, and then it's the review call, that screen share.
And then it's
reviewing it to let council see it, you know, going through whatever. You have as much time as you want to make sure, you know. And then what I say too is I recommend, hey, if it interests you, look, send us the file. It's never going to be made public until you guys explicit approval. It's not like we're going to take your information all of a sudden and post it. It's much easier to review your information when you have a search bar that you just type into, grasp the drill down. Much easier to review it in the checkbook setting than it is a 10,000 row Excel file.
Mr. Rich?
No, I was going to ask you a question, actually.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I'm just going to ask you, if this, when we vote on this night, if it passes, does that mean it starts, you know, say a week or so?
I'll be totally honest with you. If it passes tonight, we're looking at October, November start date anyway.
Of this year?
Of this year. When I talked to Mr. Reynolds about this, I let him know the situation. We are very understaffed in the city of New Carlisle. And we have already finding director working 60, 70 hours a week. It may take 30 minutes, but I'm going to require her to check every one of those line items. If something doesn't transfer over correctly from the software and goes up and live, and the numbers are wrong, it's more work at the end on our end. I think it's a great program. Transparency is also, for us, the timing is just not right. I would love this resolution to be introduced later on down. We put all this stuff on our own website anyway. To be honest with you, it's not searchable like that. I mean, that's the catalog, so don't get me wrong, but...
Well,
it's on our monthly council report, so the second council meeting of the month, the whole agenda's on there and has a list of everyone that checks that to do right, that's on there. Just again, to reiterate, I think it's a great program. I just don't think the timing's right for us, given the current staffing that we have.
Mm-hmm.
We're going through an audit. We're getting ready to upgrade our server right now. We're still working out tomorrow on the version. I would just rather see get our issues good before we put them out there for the world to see. I have no problem doing it, I just don't think it's the right time.
So even if this passes, we can still look at doing it, just not this.
Well, the language of the ordinance really worries me because I think if it's passed, it says work efficiently, resolutely. So if it does pass, I mean, at the end of the day, it's not going to be the next month or two. I mean, we're just.
And that's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, if it passes, we'll reach out to you in a couple weeks. Hey, when's a good time? I'll stop out, take less than 30 minutes, take time, and then, you know, go from there. So,
our opportunity will be September, October.
Whatever's going to work for you guys, you know, if it passes, we're not going to beat that door.
Sure.
We're going to do this right now. We'll work with you. So, we really do need, like, a partnership on this program.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not trying to force the other ones to work. It's hard to get three voluntary and try to make it as easy as possible.
I'm impressed. I mean, I've got it to what you showed, and I think it's great that people go in there and do different searches and get the graphs. The program's fantastic. I think it was a great program to start in the state of Ohio. And I really think that we're going to join it at some point in time. It's just a matter of time for us.
Do you think realistically, October, November this year?
Yeah, we still got to get through our audit, we have to do our server conversion, we have to start working on our budget for you guys see us at work session, but you don't know the multiple hours upon hours that we spent getting to you.
Well, I know, the reason I was asking is that I don't want to do it too far off the subject. I know that you were talking about getting more staff in the office.
Yes.
So I don't know if that needed to be done before this
one. I mean, ideally, I would love it. Like, me saying September, October, November is just if this passes.
Right.
In my perfect world, after we hire people in the first of the year, that 2017 should be the target year for us. Because we have the staff.
When did you convert from? So you're on the e-gov.
September 14th. So we've been on for a year.
What accounting system were you on before?
SEMA.
Okay. So you probably updated the chart of accounts, or is it the same with account structure?
Some have changed.
Some changed.
And we don't get a lot of the history.
Oh, you just started. Sure.
See, then on the sub-recision since?
Broker year.
Okay. So, and that's a good point. That's good to know. So you would only be able to go back once you implemented software solutions because your accounts changed. So you'd only be looking at a 1 year upload really to start with. So
if we had more staff next year, we would be able to put 15 and 16.
Then yeah, as far back as you go on the software solutions.
So
yeah.
That would be a little bit easier. Again, we do have
and
to
that doesn't
mandated
matter.
Right now on the prioritizing, and this was optional.
The date range doesn't matter because when you're in software solutions, you're just putting what year you want to run and running that year. So the year, but I'm just saying for your guys' site, you'd only be displaying 15 and then out for the future. So it's good to see. And that's not abnormal at all, guys, that so many folks are going through not only upgrades of the current financial system, but totally changing systems, and then it gives a chance to kind of clean up the chart of accounts and create better reports and functionalities. So
you can give them a direct report. To show us how it can be much better than the one I saw at Rover.
We've come a long way, so thank you.
That's good. Mr. Thank you. Thank you for being here, sir. That was a great report. Most of the thunder, but I like it. Randy, I'm not sure I covered when you said that band was around 999. I have a hard time hearing it. Picked it up. There's no, it's a resolution. If it passes today, there's no time on that.
No,
it's just
the language of it. The last sentence where it says more efficiently, dedicated, purposely, justly, resolutely. So if it passes, I don't want anybody to come back and say it's passed. Yet it is efficiently, and our definition of efficient is going to be different than somebody else's definition of efficient. That's it. It can pass as long as we have an understanding of that. It'll be when we are ready to go ahead.
Okay. And I'll be honest, I think it should pass.
Sure.
And with that being said, I believe in my mind that this council has always been very transparent.
Mm-hmm.
We've never had a problem with hiding anything. But I have no problem with it. You're the one, you can call in after 2 minutes, you know when the time is right, and that's up to you. I see no problem passing it. You said we can't do it. Let's sit down and we're off there,
and that's okay. And that's what we talked about today. We don't have a problem doing it. It's just the timing. I love the program. I think it's fantastic.
I do know we're on the staff, and then, like you said, there's an lot going on and everything, but yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mr. Lindsay.
Sir, he's talking about getting 2016 online if this passes tonight, and then previous years. The program that we had before, Colleen, would that program work with this or not?
He won't be able to get the history.
Do they bring over any years?
Yeah,
it depends on the conversion and the company you have, the company you're going to. I won't get into all that. So, really, you'd want to start with what we have in software solutions, and then like moving forward. So, 2015 in the year, you could upload all 2016 and then keep building out from there.
There has to be a starting point. So, say there has to be a starting point. And we can actually give you the information that you would need for the public to take a look at it. That we have the correct information.
Yes, correct. Yeah. So I don't want to take too much time. Side note. So when we launched this in December 2014, the state kind of updated their chart of accounts over 27 years. So what we had built and mapped out, we had to. They changed in 2015.
So you see there's different expense types. So we actually, you know, make it easy on you, but like, don't put what you had in CMI, because it's hard to map what you used to call all this equipment to all this equipment now. There might not be so many subcategories. Same thing with state. So they took, I think, like 1,400 expense accounts and moved it down to like 600 or 700, so they consolidate a lot. So we had to go in and like remap all these states' expenditures. So that's why I do not recommend you guys do that. Start with software solutions and move forward.
Sir, do I have your full name again?
Yes, it's Frank. I give you my card. Last name's Coastal. K.
I'll just take your card.
Okay.
I'll take your card at Coastal.
Frank, I was just going to say, you know, I'm impressed with the website too. I mean, I know they brought up the council in the past, and Randy's talked about it. I mean, it's got a lot more tools than what I was expecting it to have. A lot more builders, so it's a very impressive website.
Thank you.
Mr. Fridge, I have one question for you on this. What is your timeline? If this passes tonight, when realistically do you think this can go live for 2016? Get it up on the website.
September to October, November, that 3 month range probably is realistic, okay. But I wouldn't be surprised if it goes into 2017 after we have the full staff.
Okay, well, the reason I was asking, you said you was looking at 2017, and I figured sometime in the first 3 months maybe.
Yeah. It'd definitely be in the first quarter. I would say it actually, I would take it a step further if we're going on record. I would say that's dependent when we hire someone. So if we hire somebody the second week in January, so be it. If we hire somebody in February, so be it. If we hire somebody in March, so be it. I'm going to have a staff in place.
Okay.
Well, I'll just reiterate the review period solely to you guys.
Sure.
Again, we put it on, but as long as password protected. So you run the file, we upload it, you guys have access to it. I mean, take as long as you need to turn out that new staff hire, whatever it may be. So
I recommend you guys actually group it. It's just a matter of as long as it's on our shoulders to get it intimated under our circumstances. I think you should group it. Yeah. Because once we go do it, we're not going to go through the process again.
Any other questions, council? Colleen, go ahead.
Like, ask more questions. Is anyone else in Clark County doing this yet?
So we have. We had a really good conversation with, oh gosh, who's the promise director?
Springfield or the county?
Springfield. His name is Steve. Anyway, it was a great conversation with him. They, and you guys know, they're going to talk about this fall, so they need something to utilize. A lot of schools using this for budget campaigns as well. So Springfield's getting close. Clark County's pledged, they're committed to it. Similar, they're going through an upgrade with their software solutions. I think they're going to EGOS and EID system. We've got four school districts, Tecumseh, Reedon, Northeastern, and Southeastern.
Cool.
I had a really good conversation with the administrator at Eden last week, 2 weeks ago.
For Howard.
Say it again.
Tim Howard.
Ben Ross. And then some townships. I think Bethel Township is close. Madison, Springfield Township.
Have you ever done that? This is a very serious question. I'm not trying to be funny. Have you talked to anyone who's done this and just come back and say that's a waste of taxpayer dollars? It is.
No.
I don't do it, but have you had any of those questions?
No. The only thing similar that I've gotten is we say it's free, but it's not really free because you guys are paying that you're hiring this other guy. We just saw the staff on their websites. But for what we're paying, essentially we're paying off the tab on this, right? Charter's offices, make it free for all departments. We have some great third party validation. The level of transparency and the value that local governments are getting from it outweighs the little bit of cost that our office. really, it's a nonpartisan issue that it's just the level of government, or level of transparency in the government. A lot of folks are transparent. They put out monthly expenditure reports, they put out budget calendars, and have videotaped council meetings and minutes and meetings. What our program does is it takes up all data, those PDFs, Excel files, and puts it in a more easily digestible, easily accessible, and user-friendly format with a strong search function on it.
Cool. All right. So, motion to adopt resolution 16-4.
Yes. Right.
Yeah.
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 Marty's not there yet?
No, we're not there yet.
No,
there
you go.
We love your attention, but you can go along.
Sounds like Mr. Lowry wants to move on. Anybody else?
That is a fact.
Any other questions before we move on? Thank you for the presentation. It was very impressive.
Thank you, Frank.
Thank you for your time.
Don't mind me, I'll get backed up. So if you think of anything else, just yell at me.
I think it's safe to go home. I'm sorry you're going to say it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Take an Ohio State graduate.
Dayton, actually.
Yeah,
man.
That's
all
right.
That's a basketball field. That's
okay. It's not voting now.
Absolutely.
All right.
Pull your letter there.
It's sad that basketball will shatter.
It's sad that the basketball team will play Grand State. I get it 20 years ago, but now, totally.
They don't want to get embarrassed.
They don't want to lose to the Grand State. That's another conversation. You didn't see my face. I was smiling, and you said you'd be in. I'm kidding. I'm getting
all right, let's move on. Moving on to the manager's report.
Awesome. Pretty light this week, so I'll just jump down to the informational items. Smoke detectors, we still have some in stock. It's been on the city manager's report for probably about 4 weeks now. Please, if you do not have a working smoke detector, or if you do not have one at all, please call our fire department at 937-845-8401. We have some free ones we'd love to come install for you. Moving on is something awesome to talk about. The new playground coming to open this park. We have a ribbon cutting ceremony. The response that we've got from this playground for the permit is phenomenal. And it comes down to people at the shelter house and how the kids will have to go so far away to play equipment. That equipment is out there valued over $22,000. All we contributed was sweat equity by putting in the play herb and installing them all. So that is all the city. So, again, I'm so glad it's being well received. It's really overdue, and it is a testament to these great citizens needing something new. And we got that through a grant opportunity. We could have afforded that all. So, again, thanks to Sarah Dollinghouse and Clark County Climate Health District. But it's a gorgeous place to website updates. We did add a link to the RUOK program by the Clark County Sheriff's Office. So if you would like to visit www.newcarlisle.net, click on that link, and it is a free service for senior citizens. It's basically a checking service. Mr. Lindsay, I want to say thank you for recommending putting that online. I did send an email out to the government, but no, it is not a part of also on the website is our hydro plan notice for 2016. So please read that. If you have any questions, you can just give me or Mr. Kiko a call at the city building. And I do have to add one thing on here that I want to get to add. I do need a motion to approve. I am looking to take a much-needed vacation from July 15th, and I will return on July 26th, and I will be in Myrtle Beach.
Mr. Reynolds.
July 15th to?
I return 26th, so it's actually be through the 25th.
Can you make a motion, Mr. Reynolds?
Yes, I did.
You have to do it with my crazy family, but come on.
I have a question by Mr. Lindsay. Go ahead, sir.
The only question I have for you, sir, when you go on this vacation, it's probably well deserved.
Mm-hmm.
Are you leaving your cell phone with Ms. Harris?
I am not.
Or Mr. Kitko?
Nope.
So you cannot get me bothered.
I have my cell phone. I am leaving my laptop with Mr. Kitko. So Mr. Kitko will have all that. And if the city's not burning down or some desire to emergency going on, I'm let this fantastic gentleman handle it.
Mr. Kitko comes Mr. Bridge.
So just if you're attacked, you're out of it for have a long night.
If there's a nuclear attack, I'm probably going to be stranded for a while. I'm trying to get back up here.
No one from here.
All right, any questions before we call for the vote? Mr. Connor?
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Okay, you made the second.
Yes.
Mr. Brickley?
Yes.
Mr. McGlaughlin?
Absolutely, well worked.
Ms. Craver?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor Lauer?
Mayor Supervisor, yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
City manager can go on vacation.
Awesome. I have another one for you, then into September, by the way.
I was going to make a comment, but that's your phone.
No, wait.
Do you have anything else for the board?
I want people to accuse you of not caring about the city, because you can't agree.
That's why I'm taking my phone.
Oh, is that right?
I'm not taking my phone, I'm not taking my laptop.
That's what I...
Do you have anything else on your board, Mr. Rich?
No, that is all for the city manager's report. I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
I just had one, excuse me, Brian. Have you had any actual comments from someone who's rented the shelter house yet?
Since that's been up? No.
And I know that's kind of serious.
Yeah, it hasn't been that long. People saw, seen it going up, it's been going up for a minute. And people have kind of known it was coming, because I actually put a picture of it in the city building in two locations. So I've had a lot of questions when they see that. Oh, where's it going? It's going right next to the shelter house. Oh, good, now the kids have been so far away.
Mr. Craver?
Talk about playground equipment. I read the paper that we're getting some from the school.
Yes, we did. I was going to talk about the next council meeting. We are still yet trying to figure out where exactly we're going to put it. Tecumseh Elementary, what's the actual school? Donaldsville Elementary. They're making an outdoor classroom. And we're looking at the outdoor classroom. They had an older playground equipment geared for ages like toddlers, up to maybe 4 or 5 maybe. So little types. I need some cleaning up. Our guys went and pulled it out from their property down last week. We have a sitting. We have to determine where we're going to put it right now. It's taking a little over the clock. They originally wanted to go to the pool. I just don't think that's the best place for it. Because it's going to be a permanent install, and we're not hoping the pool doesn't open next year, but just in case it doesn't, then you're going to have to worry about that permanent install. And I really want it to be in a shaded area, somewhat shaded area, and it's just really not a lot of shaded areas.
One more thing for somebody to have to watch.
Well, back to you, but I mean, we are really lacking playground equipment here for little kids. And I'm thinking Willowwood Park, because it's really our park that's centered locally in our town. You know, Smith Park's kind of on the outer edge, not a lot of residents do. We have Carlisle Park, but Willowwood is really that one that's really in the middle of a big neighborhood. And we're getting a lot of complaints about either not having toddler swings or having playground equipment for little kids. So I think the need is going to be a little bit. I'm going to get with Howie and some other guys, we'll talk about it. But it's looked like a little.
Are we still on the search for some handicap accessible equipment?
We are, yes.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Council?
And Tyler's one, too.
Okay. Council? All right. Thank you for the report, Mr. Bridge.
No problem.
And moving on to comments from all the members of the public. Any comments?
Nothing.
All right, thank you. And moving on to committee reports, none tonight, so we'll move on to resolutions.
Mr. Ned, move we got resolution 16-04.
Read first.
Oh, yeah. Not jumping, man.
He's excited. He's excited.
Hurry.
Ordinance 16-04R, introduction, public hearing, and action tonight. Resolution for the city of New Carlisle, Ohio. To join the state of Ohio's online checkbook initiative.
Mr. Mayor, I'll make a second for Mr. Mayor. Motion to approve resolution 16-04R.
Second.
And explanation of the rest of the resolution. This is just a resolution for us to join the online checkbook online.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lauer?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craver?
Yes.
Mayor Lauer?
With my vote, I did want to stress again, Randy, that if this obviously is going to pass, that this doesn't get put in place until your office is 100% ready to move forward. I don't, you know, I've seen from your guys' comments how overloaded they are right now, and I just don't add to that. But I'm definitely for it. It's a great thing. I was impressed with
that.
Sure. It's very, very interesting. So yes,
thank you.
Anticipation.
speech?
What do you call it?
Pass the 7-0. Thank you, Mr. McIntyre.
Did you guys all get the Excel sheet I sent out with all the ordinances and how we wrote it on?
Yes.
Do you guys want to see that continuing?
Yes.
Now,
yes. Yes.
Okay.
Okay, moving on to ordinances. Mr. Collier, when you're ready. Ordinance 16-23, public hearing and action tonight. An ordinance amending ordinance 16-15 regarding the disposal of unproductive city property.
Mr. Mayor,
Mr. Lott,
I move that we pass ordinance 16-23.
Second. And the recommendation of this ordinance, we have already approved the original. This is the agreement to sell the vacant parcel to Twin Creeks. Literally, as soon after we pass it, his attorney called me back and said he wants to change three words in there. It's actually three words in a capital letter. So anytime you do that, you actually have to amend the agreement. So Section 3 was amended to address any assessment task force in the future. All the other terms of the sale are still in place.
You ready, sir? Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lauer?
Stand.
Mayor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craven?
Yes.
Ordinance 16-24, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance granting the Dayton Power and Light Company, its successors and assigns an electric franchise in the city of New Carlisle, state of Ohio, for a period of 5 years, automatically renewing for an additional period of 2 years, unless notice is given, commencing on the effective date of this ordinance.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
Move that we accept ordinance 16-24.
Yes, sir.
And in explanation to this ordinance, DP&L, every now and then, actually, the last agreement we had was over 20 years ago. This gives them permission to come in and fix anything that may be wrong in the city as far as electrical goes, and just gives them franchise rights to do so. I guess it's the easiest way to explain.
Ready, sir. Mayor Lauer?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Russell?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lauer?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craver?
Yes.
Passes 7-0. Ordinance 16-25, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into an agreement for professional accounting and consulting services.
Council?
Make a motion to adopt 16-25.
Second.
And an explanation of this ordinance. This is an ordinance for Kennedy Control and Richards to actually prepare financial statements that we have to have done for an annual audit. That's where we're going.
Any questions? Mr. Lindsay?
I guess my question is, why do we have an outside company coming in to do that? Is it because we're understaffed, or is it because we have to?
It's because we have to.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Mr. Collier?
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lauer?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craven?
Yes.
Mayor Lauer?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 7-0. Ordinance 16-26, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance adopting the tax budget for the city of New Carlisle, Iowa, for the fiscal year beginning January 1, 2017, and submitting same to the auditor of Clark County, Ohio.
Mr. Mayor,
Mr. McLaughlin,
I move that we accept ordinance 1626.
Second.
And an explanation of this ordinance, this is our yearly ordinance we do for the tax budget. Again, this is the first step out of many. Tax budgets really deal with just getting our revenues down. Later in time, we'll become more expensive where we actually get through and chop stuff.
Any questions? Mr. Collier? Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craven?
Yes.
Mayor Mike Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
I have to abstain. I
6-0-1. Ordinance 16-27, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the placement on the ballot of a tax levy renewal for public health purposes.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
I move we accept ordinance 16-27.
Second.
And explanation of this ordinance, this is just, again, the first step out of actually two that council will see. First step is necessity, which is what we're here for now. After we get this approved and the waiting period goes by, I'll send a certification letter out to the auditor, and he'll come back and he'll wait for, we'll wait for his auditor certification. Then we'll have another ordinance come along for an ordinance to actually proceed. So again, this is just a step out of, step one out of many. But we'll have more detailed information at that second reading as far as the millage and the breaks and all that stuff.
Council, any questions? Mr. Collier, when you're ready, please.
This is a renewal. So if we vote on this and it goes on the ballot, voters don't like it, then they have their say and they can decide whether they want to renew this or not.
Yes. Yes.
That's great. Because it's, you know, if it's something that's on the ballot, I think that they should be able to decide yes or no. Could you, I know the specific language here, the ballot language talks about how much per evaluation, what the total amount of cents is. Do you mind saying that for the record?
Where are you at?
You have any seats?
This is right in here. Can you talk into me, Mr. Max?
Which amounts to 10 cents for every $100 evaluation for 6 years? Just how much that would.
Well, we don't know that until we get the certification back.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, so that's step two.
That's step two.
That's step two.
Thank you.
No problem. He has to start by property values and all that, it's all based
on. Yeah, sure.
I do, if you want to know from last year, I actually looked on that last year, last time I was on, I think it was in 2010. Then for the average $100,000 home was $30.26 a year. So again, we're not going to quote that, but that's just what it is, that's what it was in 2010.
Right.
So that when we send that letter, I'll call Rick, he'll come back and say this is what it's going to cost in 2016. So,
right.
Yep, no problem.
When you're ready, Mr. Carter.
Give me a second, please.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lauer.
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lauer.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Passes 7-0. The remainder of the ordinances are just introductions. Action on 7-18-16. Ordinance 16-28, an ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for the purchase of natural gas. Ordinance 16-29, an ordinance authorizing the city manager execute a memorandum of understanding, MOU, with the Board of Clark County Commissioners. Ordinance 16-30, an ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for the purchase of propane gas. And ordinance 16-31, an ordinance to declare PNC Bank a depository for the city of New Carlisle's funds.
I just want to interrupt them. If you guys, if council has any questions on any of these upcoming ordinances, shoot me an email. I'll try to address them before I leave for vacation because these are actually voted on them.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Lindsay.
You can't go back. I'm sorry.
Next Chautauqua concert is will be on July 10th at 6:30 p.m. here at the Smith Park stage. That's all I have.
Thank you, sir. Any other discussion tonight before we adjourn?
Executive session, not tonight. I'm sorry.